So for every business person, every time you step out to try out something, the question is, are you able to recoup some profits off it? And if not, what can be changed for you to make sure that you can then make the money out of that investment? It's important for you to study the market environment first before you can put any money out there as a business person. These are just some of the basic things that we think you must understand here on The Business Show as we step out to give you all the views and the things that you need moving forward in such times to make your business count. Thank you for joining us on this week's edition. My name is Simon. Once again, welcome to the show. And this week we'll start with the private sector and how they can be supported to boost export. We know for a fact that their production volumes, well, you would say, can be understandably taken up as something good. But what else can be done to support the private sector to increase their production and the volumes that are exported out of Uganda? This week on Views from the Top, I speak to the Secretary General of the Chamber of Commerce here in the country, who tells us what they are doing to support the private sector to increase on the volumes of goods exported. But she also says associations need to streamline their operations so that the government can listen to their concerns. My first question to her, though, is what is her assessment of the private sector generally?
Blessing or Mitcha Immaculate. I'm the Acting Secretary General for Uganda National Chamber of Commerce and Industry. Uganda National Chamber of Commerce is the oldest umbrella body for private sector in Uganda. We will be celebrating 90 years of enhancing business opportunities, both internally here in Uganda, but also on an international level.
Okay. Yeah. All right, so let's talk generally about the private sector. If someone asked the Secretary General of the Chamber how the private sector is performing, really, what would you say?
The private sector is actually 80% an employee of all the people here in Uganda. That means we contribute the biggest percentage to the GDP. We have also contributed a lot of employment for both the skilled and the non-skilled. We're also adding a lot of value to the productions that we're doing. But also on a regional level, we are providing a competitive advantage for most of the products that are in Uganda. I would think that Uganda wouldn't survive without the private sector.
Mm. Yes. All right, so we've seen several members joining, and like you said, 80% is a huge number. The question would be, do you think there is enough market for all these different organizations or companies that are producing locally here?
Well, I would say, first of all, you need to know that Uganda is one of the largest and the youngest populations, not just in Africa, but in the world.
Yeah.
That means that we have a very high consuming power and we are intentional spenders. There's a lot of market. And when I talk about a lot of market, I mean the different stages of production. People will still buy poor quality goods. People will buy average quality goods. People will still buy high quality goods. So there's market for every stage of production or for every stage of business here in Uganda. But when we talk about the market, we don't just look at the local markets that Uganda is introducing us to. We're also looking at the markets that surround Uganda. You know, most Ugandans say that Uganda is landlocked, but for us as Chamber of Commerce, we believe that Uganda is land-licked. We have quite a number of engaging neighbors that provide market for the commodities. So yes, we have a lot of markets. We're not even able to take in all the markets that we have in Uganda, and yet we are still penetrating the outside market. So there's a lot of market for Uganda.
All right, let's really talk about penetrating the market. And I know that the Chamber is doing really a lot to try and help expand the market. Because look, one would argue that around this time, there's so many products being put on the market, but maybe the spending power amongst Ugandans is not as huge. So if we can aid these businesses to push goods across, the region, then it would be a good thing. Do you think these markets out of Uganda then offer what would be an alternative for the businesses here?
Well, I would like to highlight that as a mandate of Uganda National Chamber of Commerce, we have signed quite a number of MOUs. So that exposes us to the available markets that we have. And when you talk about available markets, we're also looking at the just specific product markets that are available. First of all, Uganda has already signed the East African Community Agreement that's already ready market for 7 countries. Congo, having joined us recently with one of the largest populations still in the world. Then we have the Great Lakes market that also has 15 countries. We have IGAD that equally has more than 20 countries. We have the African Continental that has been over advertised now. It has 54 countries, but also there are markets outside Uganda. So we have tried as much as possible to be penetrating, you know, the different markets that we have available. Recently we were in South Sudan. That is one of the available markets. We're in Congo, another available market. We're already penetrating so many other activities. We are hosting Somalia as one of the markets that we're looking at. So yes, Uganda is trying as much as possible to, one, do a lot of research on product and also that available markets, too, to get to identify the policies, the non-tariff barriers, the principles that govern such markets. Number three, what is required there? How can they penetrate them? What are the barriers that these people are facing? And how can the government, jointly with the private sector, be able to go around them? So that we have already commenced with the markets. This is not the first year that Uganda has wanted to penetrate different markets, but we have taken various steps towards, you know, getting into these markets, getting to penetrate them. Actually, we are exporting a lot. There are countries that have recognized Uganda as being one of the countries that are having the biggest exportation. When you go to South Sudan, for example, we are taking almost 80% of the food in South Sudan, but that is not the only country that we are penetrating in terms of the markets that we're talking about.
All right, I tell you what, someone really want to commend the Chamber of Commerce for the different roles they are taking in trying to widen the market for the businesses of the private sector. But the question would be, what do you think then explains all of a sudden not being able to utilize these opportunities that we are talking about?
Thank you so much. So when we talk about availability of markets, we're not only looking at the population in a country. The availability of a particular private sector to be able to penetrate that market is that, one, the commodities that are required to be taken there meet the standards that have already been set by the local standards bureau, for every country has a standards bureau. Number two is that you're able to compete favorably with the already existing people in the market. When you go to markets like Congo, you're going to find also countries like Kenya, like Rwanda, like Nigeria, trying to penetrate that market. In fact, Congo is importing milk from Belgium, from Europe. So the ability for us to compete favorably with those that are already in existing markets. And then, of course, number three is in regards to the tariff and non-tariff barriers, the policies that have been put in place by these local governments to protect their own domestic market, which becomes very difficult for us to penetrate. So yes, when we talk about markets are available, are we ready as Ugandans? We are trying to get ready. And this is in terms of quality and quantity. People that are outside doing demands for these goods, they want it in bulk. Are we able to meet the quantity that is required? Not most of the time. So we are trying to increase the productivity of the Ugandan sectors so that when they're getting there, they can at least produce to the quantity that is required. Number two is in terms of the quality that is required. Most of the people here in Uganda want to produce and sell immediately. They might not be able to go through the steps of getting the Q mark, getting the quality that is required, among other things. So when they want to take their goods to a particular country, they say, no, that you don't meet the market. And most of the time, yes, we even meet the market the first time, the second time, the third time. Then, you know, we mix up a few issues and then we don't meet the market. So we might not be able to penetrate now as much as possible. And one thing that I also would like to highlight is the fact that there's a lot of protectionism. Some of these policies that we have signed allow us to go to these markets, but when you reach there, people are trying to protect their domestic market growth. So you find that our products are quite high. There's a lot of corruption that you have to get in the system for you to start trading, which also increases the cost of your products. So at the end of the day, when you take your goods to a country like maybe Sudan, to a country like Congo, your commodities will be very costly. And of course, another challenge with the international markets is of means of movement, how to get their logistic movement. So you will find that people charter planes, cargo planes to maybe Congo from Belgium, from Europe, and it is very cheap for them to get their goods there. But unfortunately, for now, us, it's not as cheap as it should be. So that means that if I've incurred a lot of money with transporting the goods, they will also be very expensive. I cannot compete favorably in that market, and that means that I am going to cease to identify that as a ready market for the Ugandan commodities.
Let's talk, you mentioned their quality, which I know, you know what, a good number of Ugandans can produce quantity. Mm. I want you to address the issue of quality and the impact it has on us not being able to compete favorably on the market, the other side. And then the most obvious question that everyone would want to ask is, so how can the Chamber of Commerce then help us to cut down the cost of, you know, shipping the goods and taking them across the markets?
All right, thank you so much. I would like to highlight something on the quality bit of it. When we talk about quality, it's not that Ugandans do not actually want to comply with quality. The cost of complying with quality is very, very high. I know that we've done quite a number of advocacies on behalf of our private sector to reduce on the cost of getting a Q mark, on the cost of being verified by the Uganda the Bureau, the Standards Bureau, and they have really done their level best to reduce, but the cost is still very high. So most of the people realize that they can actually sell without going through that process, and then they do not get the Q mark. And other countries will not understand that you decided not to get the Q mark in your own country because maybe the cost is high. So for them, they would expect that you have clearance of that particular. And now we are using the common East African clearance. So once you get cleared here by our Standards Bureau, then you can get to other East African countries with that same clearance. But it's very costly to actually to go through the system, and the system is very tiring. You can apply and spend over 6 months without even anything happening. The cost is attached on a product, it's per product. And every year you still have to pay another amount of money for that clearance. It's not that it's a one-off. So most of these Ugandan companies have decided that they can do without it. And you see, there's not a lot that is being done to those companies that have not invested in the quality assurance. They're also still selling their products on the market, other than supermarkets where there's a lot of policing, but the outside the rest of the market, it becomes very difficult for me to be competing with someone who has not gone through the standards and we are sharing the same market. So that's the first thing that is on the standards. How this can actually be addressed is that incentives need to be given to the private sector and the business community. People are into a lot of production. There's a lot you can, if the foreigners are coming in and getting incentives towards so many of these things, I think incentives can be given to our private sector, and they indicate that for the first maybe 4 years, you have a waiver. Please go through the quality assurance process, get the Q mark, and be able to take your goods there. But also a lot of sensitization on the need for this quality to actually be consistent. The first time my quality is good, the second time it's not good, it becomes very demoralizing. And in fact, we're almost being, you know, expelled from the European market because of the quality consistency that we're not complying with. So I think that's one of the ways that we can help with that. You asked another question on how Chamber can really help. First of all, I would like to also indicate that the importance of Chambers of Commerce cannot be re-emphasized. When you go to different countries, you will see the value that is attached to Chambers of Commerce. And this is in line with its advocacy, number one. We do a lot of advocacy on policy. We do presentations of papers in Parliament. We're able to meet the minister. We sit on so many boards. So they can utilize us to make sure that we can do a lot of advocacy on their behalf. We have done a lot of advocacy for people in line with even the standards that we're talking about. There was a reduction that was made. They used to pay 1 million, now they pay 500,000. That's almost half of the reduction that we are requesting for. So Chamber of Commerce can actually help with a lot of advocacy. The other thing that Chamber of Commerce can actually help with our business sector is take advantage of the fact that we have sister chambers of commerce. Do not be cheated. We can do due diligences for the different countries. If you want to carry out your goods, maybe transactions and everything in maybe Russia, in maybe India, in maybe so many other countries, we have sister chambers of commerce that can help you do due diligence to make sure that you're dealing with the right and authentic company. The other thing is, of course, in identification of markets. These people already share this information. Chambers share information in between the different chambers for them to be able to identify and say, we need avocados in Uganda, from Uganda, we need maybe honey from Uganda, we need so many other things from Uganda. So this is information that we have, this is information that we already share with our private sector, and this is information that the business community can benefit from.
Amazing conversation there. And you know, one thing that is certainly for sure is that for every business person that is looking to export, volume is good, quantity rather is also okay, but quality is paramount. No one is going to buy your goods simply because you have it in bulk. It's important that it is in bulk but also of quality. And of course, the other thing that you need to pay attention to, if there's a deal that is out there to export, why don't you, as business people, get in associations so that you export as a team, so you can be able to meet the demand that is on the other side of the market, rather than you taking up the deal, you supply once, and when they look up to you again, your phones are off. You're watching The Business Show with me, Simon. Let's take another break now. When we get back, I'll be telling you what's happening in how to make money.
Maintaining the good quality of coffee is key. Especially for consumers who are really coffee lovers. If you make a fake coffee or a coffee which is not processed well, a known coffee consumer will not like it, and eventually you lose the market. But the quality is monitored right from the gardens. Okay.